biometric identification from the fingerprints to the DNA swabs to identify who these people were. We told them that if they gave us their arms, if they consolidated at Ashraf, and if they subjugated themselves to our interrogations, which basically the biometrics, and then everyone in the 3,400 were interviewed by multiple U.S. agencies, that they would then become protected persons. We will take care of them, make sure no harm comes to them, especially in the country of Iraq, where if it wasn't in the green zone, it was all red zone. We did phase two. Phase two in 2004 went beyond the biometrics. Each member of the 3,400 were taken off of Camp Ashraf, interviewed, and offered an opportunity to leave the organization. They were then asked their background, because at the time I thought I had 3,400 raging terrorists. Well, taking it back a year or two, all of you know where you were on 9/11 when you heard about the Twin Towers. I was in the Pentagon, and I was the director of security for the Army staff on that morning. So I was very happy to have these 3,400 terrorists detained. And I told my soldiers, firm, maintain very firm control. But as time went on and we did phase two, and I started listening to these interviews and started hearing that this young female member went to Florida State University. And this older man was at Eastern Michigan. And I started seeing the number of U.S. citizens in this organization, let alone the green card holders. But were they afforded the rights that U.S. citizens should be afforded by our own government? No, they're still in detention. The inmates at Guantanamo Bay have better living conditions than the people who are in Ashraf and that were now have turned over to the Iraqis and are being kept at Camp Liberty. During phase two, how many of the 3,400 do you think the FBI, the CIA, the DIA, and our other organizations wanted us to call out, apprehend, so they could be charged? None. Not one. In June of 2004, all of those organizations left Ashraf and really left the Army holding the bag. It's like, what do we do now with these individuals? Well, are they terrorists? No. Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld sent us an order that said they are now protected persons under the Fourth Geneva Convention, and it was my unit that individually issued protected persons ID tags, and I was the first one to get an ID tag. I am ID tag number one, and it was strictly to show them, hey, I will put my name on this too. Well, so much for protected persons. I came back to Iraq in 2006, stayed 2007, and was there for 2008. I was responsible for rebuilding the Iraqi police during what you know as the surge. I was General Petraeus' senior military policeman. I put a police academy right on top of Camp Ashraf. You know what I've learned about that academy? I sat and promised the men and women at Ashraf that this is a police academy. Don't worry, nothing will happen to you. We're keeping it separate. That academy became the launching base of the attacks against the people at Camp Ashraf. I don't sleep well at night. We went on and tried our very best as the Army to get the Red Cross, to get the UNHCR, any organization in there to say, can you take care of these people? Can you get them out? None. When I went back in 2008, the only difference between the 3,400 that I originally detained is that some of them were dead. And now many more are dead. And I would ask you this, how are these people? Who are they? Young men and women, older men and women, Americans, Germans, all of our Army in descent. But yet we have them confined there at Camp Liberty. We have turned them over to the Iraqis after promising. This is not just Philip saying this. We put that promise in writing, the United States government. That's our government, which I grew up and I believe in, that we have the moral high ground. I saw us come off that high ground. And we're still off that high ground. And any of you question anything about the conditions they're under, ask this question of our own State Department. Show them the picture of Captain Liberty, current. Let me ask one of the news people from my area, Cleveland, Nebraska, to go in and just film Camp Liberty. I guarantee you, you will be denied. We have had our own U.S. congressmen and senators go over to Baghdad and be refused to even see the condition these people are under. Well, we set the conditions for a modern-day concentration camp, and that's where these people are to this day, and there's American citizens in there that many of you don't even know about. It's time we live up to what we promised them in 2003, protection. We can bring them out. Bring them out and put them at Fort Chaffee or one of the other locations where we brought the boat people out from. The Haitians, the Cubans, the Mariel boat. Bring the people out. But these aren't only people that are coming from Cuba or post-Vietnam when we brought over all of the people, many of the people. These are American citizens, and these are Iranian citizens who we promised something, and now we're letting them be slaughtered. I would be happy to talk to any of you offline. These are real people there. And I can't overemphasize. My forces command and commanded at Guantanamo Bay. I know the conditions those individuals are under. The conditions that these people are under that we promised protection are far worse, and we're responsible for that. Picture yourself as a U.S. citizen in another country, and the United States government says, we'll take care of you. Well, 10 years ago, this is a picture I brought. You're looking at a table from Nowruz, the Iranian New Year. This picture was taken of me and many of the Iranians in front of a similar table. Only it was a Camp Ashraf. 10 years later, they're still in confinement. And very few of you even know about it. It's time to do the right thing and bring these people home. I'll let the others talk about that.